I love your ponytail in the film. Why have you cut
Achha,
it?
You don't have to suddenly start going professional.
Okay.
And start talking about the film. We can talk about each other.
Each other's lives.
You know, yeah. It's, you know, it's casually we break yeah. into our conversation.
Candid and,
then,
and
get on to the film then.
Okay.
Straight away you're attacking my hairstyle. So what I want to ask the two of you is, sir, very frankly and honestly, you have to tell me, how do you do it? Yeah? Just film after film, how do you perform like this? Yeah? I want to know so that I can perhaps make an attempt to imitate, copy, learn. Now this is serious conversation, get serious now. Yeah, you don't have to go cockeyed. What is the first thought that comes into your mind when you read a line?
Seriously?
I genuinely want to know, because this is a craft which I'm not aware of. I'm unable to do that myself. So I want to know how you do it.
So, but there are many things that...
Yeah, but you do... I feel that you... that you think and then you take it in and there is some reaction somewhere here and that then you decide how much to let go and how much to come out from here and how much to keep within.
Thank
I was just telling the gentleman who was here before that one of the qualities of what I believe of a good artist is if he can listen properly, if he can listen correctly.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a bigger art, to be able to
Above.
Listen to your colleague without speaking.
Okay.
And because if you're going to be listening to me properly, then obviously I'm doing something right, therefore you're listening to me properly. And that's how I would like to relate to artists performing.
I think...
Do you think that that's a fair judgment?
A big part of it is what you have with the other actor.
Mm-hmm.
And what's happening between the two people in front of the camera. I don't think that you can really actually do it alone, or it's something that is isolated from others around you. So I can't see it objectively, but I don't know. I don't think about how I'm doing it.
What if you didn't have somebody who you felt was delivering the kind of response that you need to be able to respond to him? You know what I mean? Would that become an awkward situation for you?
I would still try to do what I'm supposed to do,
yeah,
and be true to what I'm supposed to be feeling at that point.
Right.
Yeah, you're not always fortunate to have great rapport, professional rapport, or a chemistry with the other actors.
I don't know how you see a scene. I mean, we're really getting very technical here, but what the heck.
Mm-hmm.
When you get the scene, you're... A lot of people just want to read their lines first,
mm-hmm,
and say, what have I got to do, what have I got to do, and finish. But I think unconsciously somewhere, all artists, when they read the scene, they also read the other person's lines and they actually mentally perform those lines before they come to their own line.
Mm-hmm.
Do you find yourself doing that sometimes? And then, worse, mm-hmm, if the way you have performed in your mind about the other person, he doesn't deliver the way when the camera rolls, then it's disbalancing. It sort of unbalances you. I sometimes feel that.
Yeah, I mean, overall, if things on the set are not just what I'd imagined them to be, then I really feel like, oh my God, I shouldn't have thought of it to be like this.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone has their own perception of the scene and their character. But most of the time, it's not what you've imagined. So, I prefer not to have a picture in my head about what's going to happen.
Okay. Also, the reverse could happen.
Like,
you have imagined that this character should behave like this, should speak like this, and when he does speak like this, this is the way I'm going to respond with my lines. But what if he surprises you by doing something which is even better than what you had imagined? That
yeah.
also can throw you off, doesn't it?
Yeah, that would challenge my own spontaneity and responses, I think.
Yeah.
So you have
I find that
prepared.
Happening a lot when I'm working with you.
So,
you know, when I read a scene with you, I imagined in my mind that, okay, Tabu is going to behave like this and speak the lines like this. And I will say like this. But when the camera rolls, you surprise me by doing totally different from what I had imagined. Better, obviously. And I suddenly find myself controlling myself, checking myself, because somewhere in my mind I've already mentally decided this is the way I'm going to act. But because your response has been different from what I had imagined, I have to quickly do a rethink in my mind and then perform. So it's a tough job. What I'm trying to say is a tough job working with you.
Please don't say that. Others will not work with me.
Now that I have honestly analyzed, in the middle of this very serious debate,
discussing
about acting, cinema and art and acting, and
performing and performance.
Just imagine that you're with Mira or somebody like that, or some of the several French films that you've done.
I have to write a thesis about chemistry between actors.
Yeah, you should be able to do that. So come on.
So
this is a free for all. You can abuse me. You can do what you like. Just don't hit me because I don't like your high heels.
You're not predictable either. No, I think your personality is that, and it comes through in your work.
I'm not predictable. Okay.
At least I don't think that I can predict what you're going to do in the shot. But having said that, I think also in Cheeni Kum.
Can I remind you where you last stopped?
Yeah.
You were saying, having said that, I wish to say that you're a pretty stupid actor or whatever. Say it. Don't hesitate to say whatever you want to say.
I think in Cheeni Kum, you're not your usual self.
Okay.
Yeah.
And what is my usual self? My usual predictable self or...
No. The streak of unpredictability...
is lessened.
No. Is, it's always there.
Okay. Okay.
As a person, as a performer.
I'm not there in Cheeni Kum like that. Is that a negative or is that a...
It's a great thing.
It's a great positive.
Yeah.
I love you, Tabu. Thank you so much. And for a moment, I thought that...
See,
you might kick me or something.
Oh, yeah, right. But see, I loved what I felt while working with you, personally. So, I think whatever I felt has come across on screen. I don't know how you felt.
34.
Jane Dona.
Very old.
Jane Jane.
64. Very young.
Yeah, you see, this brings us back to how we started this argument.
Oh.
Is that you talked about chemistry between artists and so on and so forth. Does a bit of the fact that you know the person you're acting with personally help or dissuade you? I say this because if I know my colleague rather well, yes, there is a certain comfort level because you're easy, but I think that something holds you back when you want to actually do something which the scene demands, and maybe you hold yourself back.
If you know that person.
If I know that
person. Or if you don't know that
person. If I know the person, then I find myself sometimes maybe holding it back. If I have to...
Why?
Scream at you or get emotional with you, I just feel that because I know you so well, I may not be able to go full out. And I say this because I felt that in my personal experiences, on many an occasion, that happened to me. I was working in a film called Shakti with Dilip Sir, and my co-artist, the lady opposite me, was Smita Patil. And even though I had known of her and seen her on television and so on and so forth, I had not actually ever worked with her. So she has come with... for me, as a certain amount of knowledge that, you know, where she's coming from, who she is, and so on and so forth. And the first scene that I had to do with her was a rather important and difficult one for me. It was the drunk scene where, I don't know if you know the film at all.
Very, very.
When I talked to her that...
About your father?
My father having two sons. Or I having two fathers. And for me, I was very apprehensive as to how I'm going to be able to do this very awkward scene, very difficult. I've got to be drunk, I've got to be emotional. I'm talking about my father who I feel is not behaving correctly with me. And I'm doing that with this lady in front of me who's a very accomplished artist. But it's the first time I'm going to be working with him. For some reason, I think if you're working with somebody new, very, very guardedly somewhere, an impression comes inside you that I must do well, I must impress this person right mm-hmm. now by my performance, because it's the first time we're working together.
Right.
And because of that situation, you come out doing something really good. But that shouldn't happen.
I mean, it could work in a good or bad way. I mean, it could work either ways.
Yeah.
So maybe something else comes out, and maybe if the person was somebody else, something else comes out. But that's the truth of the moment, I feel.
Yeah.
I mean, there are good and bad points about working with people you don't know, and also with people you know. Like you said, yeah. if you knew somebody really well, you'd have a tough time like slapping them or
exactly, yeah.
shouting at them. So that could be a negative.
Yeah, yeah. So did you feel that during the making of Cheeni Kum? With anyone? Me, with Zohra ji, with Paresh?
With Zohra ji, yeah, because she's a very, strong personality, and you could get intimidated. Mm-hmm. I mean, I got intimidated by her. Maybe because of, she
yeah,
does.
Yeah.
And you feel like she's going to scold you any
yeah,
minute,
yeah.
you know. And with you, I felt, maybe because I've known you, and it was not very different from how we are,
mm-hmm.
How our interaction is
right.
in the film. With Paresh, it was, I worked with him, so it was. And David could not believe that I was literally like crying, because I didn't want to slap him. He's my director, how can I slap him? So yeah, I understand. But in Cheeni Kum, Zohra ji, yeah, I felt that. With you, there were probably moments where, because I was working with you for the first time, there were moments when I felt, but on the whole, no. Maybe because the relationship of the characters, I mean, if we were doing something really outlandish, maybe I would have felt anything, but not anything.
Yeah. The other problem that I sometimes face is that having done this situation with my colleague, the moment it's over, we're out of that groove and into friendship and, you know, backslapping and ha-ha, hee-hee, hoo-hoo. And then to quickly come back again into the character is you know, it's a tough job.
Yeah,
whereas if you don't know the artist as well, then you do your job and you go and sit somewhere else. And, you know, you're aloof because
right.
you don't know the person.
You're detached.
Yeah.
Doesn't
so
matter.
I think it's very helpful at that point of time to say to yourself, yeah, she's just talking normal as we would when we meet socially. Is that a very big step that you have to take?
What?
To get into the role and suddenly start behaving that character as opposed to your friendly atmosphere with me off the camera.
Related to Cheeni Kum?
Yeah. Cheeni Kum or in general. Yeah.
Depends.
Because I think that, you know, a lot of people who view cinema and view the art of acting sometimes overlook this factor that, you know, what we go through psychologically or mentally when we keep jumping so rapidly. You know, when the camera starts, you're suddenly all geared up and then it goes off. And somebody should take our blood pressure when this is happening.
Yeah.
But it's intriguing for me to know how you would adjust in a situation like that, or how do you adjust?
Depends on how larger than life the character is from my real self. Of course, every character, no character is your real self, and you have to become somebody else in some way. But if it is the disparity between what I'm feeling that moment and between what I have to do is so huge, then it would be very difficult, and of course it would adjust some, require some adjustment. But how do you feel about it?
I think that with time, and because of the number of years that we spend in front of the camera, and the number of films that we do with such, you know, rapidity, we somehow become almost mechanical as far as the change in attitude is concerned. I'm not saying that all of us become mechanical in front of the camera with, as far as our
right.
roles are concerned.
Right.
But I think that this process of jumping in and jumping out and jumping in and jumping out has almost
become a habit.
Yeah, it's almost like a habit.
Yeah.
And sometimes in society, in social life, in our real life, we find ourselves doing that.
Yeah.
And it's very intriguing for an outsider who's not in films, who's unaware of how we behave, to adjust to that. So, you know, you and me could be talking and say, "Toh maine usko ye kaha, toh wo wahan gaya." So they actually start looking if there's somebody there, you know. But okay. This is something that we would do normally in front of a camera, right. As part of our acting ability.
Yeah. So that cinematic
they get so
language,
taken up, they actually start looking, where did he look and who is that person that he's talking to?
Because that's
to?
The language that we are used to speaking,
exactly,
cinematic
yeah.
language which nobody else can understand. That's why I think it's difficult to get along or understand people outside of the film industry for
right.
them to understand us
right.
and
yeah.
for us to get along well with them.
Yeah.
So.
And this has been a very often complaint from people who are unaware of this practice of ours.
Mm-hmm.
It's not really a practice, nature's not that we have deliberately put it on, but they find this sometimes offensive. And therefore, a lot of misunderstanding takes place. They feel that there's a certain amount of arrogance because they are a clique of their own. They behave differently.
But we are,
you know,
and we do.
Fine.
Yeah.
But this is because of our profession.
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
If we were to sit with a group of doctors, they would say nothing else but, you know, maine aaj jo kiya, jaise kiya, isko kata, and that would be really strange to us.
Exactly, yeah.
Because who knows what they talk when they're on the operating table. I mean, I've witnessed an operating theater while this is on, and they don't talk anything about medical. They are cutting away somebody and say, "Toh, aaj golf mein kidhar khelne ka hai?" They kaha, "Jo kya kar raha hai aaj, shaam ko movie jayenge." And they are performing some very intricate details
on a body.
Likewise, when we have a situation, I don't know whether we immediately relate to that as yet another performance or, we know what he's going to say. Let's say we're driving on the road, an accident happens. Okay, sometimes you get really involved because somebody is hurt and all that. But do you unconsciously see yourself looking at other people's expressions? Wo rickshaw wala kaise dekh raha hai? You know, this happens. It's not deliberate.
No, it's not deliberate.
Yeah.
And sometimes I'm looking at, am I giving the right expression right now or not?
Yeah. I hope I'm not going to be misunderstood. I better get a little grim looking or whatever it is.
So this is how I'm supposed to look if I'm worried, and this is how I'm supposed to look in a public gathering or at a funeral or at a birthday party or this thing.
Yes.
So am I making the right face sort of a thing?
Yeah.
So it's,
this is a dilemma. That's a dilemma with all of us.
It's the truth about all of us also. Sometimes, I mean.
So how does somebody know what your real self is? Never. Because you never know when we're putting.
But
I mean, right now we're giving our best performances as we're talking to each other.